Dear friends, beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, this is Brother Frank greeting you from the Mission Center in Krefeld, Germany. It's always a privilege to speak to you about the Lord, about His return, about Bible prophecies being fulfilled in our time, actually to show forth the great plan of salvation. God from eternity has made a plan, and this plan is now coming to completion. The main subject is the return of Christ and the fulfillment of Bible prophecies in our time. Connected with it is the restoration of the New Testament church to where she was at the very beginning. God used the prophets in the Old Testament to foretell what is going to take place. Then He used the apostles, who were witnesses, what took place when Scripture was fulfilled and all the promises from the Old Testament became a reality here on earth. In Ephesians 3, from verse 1, we can see how the Apostle Paul did emphasize the mystery that was made known to him by divine revelation. And then he states in verse 5, as it was revealed to his apostles and prophets by the Holy Spirit. Everything is divine revelation. Now, speaking about the end time, about the return of the Lord, about the things which are now taking place as a fulfillment of Bible prophecies, we have to emphasize that before the return of Christ, there has to be a total restoration of all things. The New Testament church at the end must be as she was at the beginning. And at the beginning, God placed into His church the different ministries, apostles, prophets, teachers, and so forth. At the last round, when the Lord is going to move in a very great and mighty way, in the last phase, the New Testament church will experience, before the actual return of Christ, we shall have a restoration, the same power of God, the same teachings, the same baptism in the Holy Spirit, the same baptism in water. Everything will be and will have to be the same as it was in the beginning, because Jesus Christ is Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Beloved friends, we have to understand we're not living in the days of Reformation. We are living at the time of restoration of all things. I'd like to show you today the importance of the teachings of the 12 apostles. You can even go to Revelation chapter 21, when we see the New Jerusalem and we are told about the 12 gates and also about the 12 pillars. There we find the names of the 12 apostles. Revelation chapter 21, verse 14. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. We must take things seriously. We cannot just think we're going to make it if we wish to be in the New Jerusalem, if we wish to participate in the first resurrection. We have to comply with God's word in total obedience. We must be able to say, as a son of God, not my, but thy will be done. When we read about the 12 apostles, we can also go to Revelation chapter 12, and it says here in verse 1, "And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars." Now, we're not going to go into detail about all this symbolic language, but everybody understands, just like a woman receives the seed and then gives birth to life, so the New Testament church is shown as a woman receiving the seed of the Word of God, but she's crowned with the teachings of the 12 apostles. You can go to Revelation chapter 1, and it says here in verse 20, Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, "The mystery of the seven stars," remember 12 stars, a crown of 12 stars, the teachings of the 12 apostles, the New Jerusalem, having 12 gates, with the names of the 12 tribes of Israel, having 12 foundations, with the names of the 12 apostles. And here we're told about the seven churches, which represent the one church throughout the New Testament period. And it says here in Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, "The mystery of the seven stars." So stars in the hands of the Lord are messengers, men of God, sent with a message to the church. And the apostles have the message to the New Testament church. And it says here in Revelation chapter 2, verse 2, "You have tried those who claim to be apostles, and they are not. You found them to be liars." Not claims, but reality. Our teaching and preaching, our practice must be precisely as it was in the days of the apostles. Anybody knows the church history that only a few years after the beginning, there were brethren teaching various doctrines which were no more the original teachings of the apostles. So we must make sure that we do believe according to the scripture, and therefore the restoration of all things is necessary. If we go to the Old Testament, then in 1 Kings chapter 18, the man of God was placing the altar where it actually had been before, rebuilding it, and then taking the 12 stones according to the 12 tribes of Israel. 1 Kings 18, 30 and 31. "And Elijah said unto all the people, Come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob." So we must go back to the harmony of the scripture. Elijah thought he is the only one who remained left. But then the Lord said, there are still 7,000 who did not bow their knees. So he, as the prophet of that day, called the people of God together. He rebuilt the altar. He repaired it. And then the people had to make the decision. In the same way, the Lord himself made the promise in the last chapter, in the last verses of the Old Testament. He said, I read it, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. So when you have such a promise, you must go back to what Elijah actually did, to know what the Elijah would do, who should come just before the great and dreadful day of the Lord would be. John the Baptist came before the day of salvation started. He prepared the way of the Lord. But this Elijah, who is to come before the great and terrible day of the Lord, he must restore. I give you the scriptural references about the preparing which took place at the first coming of Christ. It's Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, Malachi 3, verse 1, Matthew 11, verse 10, Mark 1, 2, and 3, Luke 1, 17, Luke 1, 76, Luke 3, 3, and 4. In all these scriptures, we find the word prepare. John prepared. But the prophetic ministry, which now is before the return of Christ, is connected with the word restore. You can read it in Matthew 17, 11, in Mark chapter 9, verse 12, in Joel chapter 2, verse 25. And if we go to the prophet Isaiah, we find how the word repair and restore is being used in the Old Testament, and then we shall go back to the New Testament. In the prophet Isaiah, chapter 58, we shall read verse 11 and 12. And the Lord shall guide thee continuously and satisfy thy soul in drought and make fat thy bones, and thou shalt be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose water does not fail. So here is a promise. And then it goes on to verse 12. And they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up the old foundations of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the past to dwell in. So in the Old Testament, we also have these promises. We must know that the whole plan of salvation was already spoken of in the Old Testament. Now here, we have to pay attention to the few words like old foundations, repairer of the breach, restorer of the past to dwell in. Now, we go to the New Testament, to the well-known scripture in Matthew 17. And I want you to know, beloved brothers and sisters, this is God's time for God's people. It is not enough to know what great evangelists or charismatic personalities are doing. We must know what God promised for this day. We must have part in that which he does according to his promised word. In Matthew 17, we have the record of Moses and Elijah appearing on the mountain of transfiguration. Peter, John, and James were present, and the question was placed before the Lord, why do the scribes say that Elijah must first come? And then, of course, we have the answer from the lips of Jesus, our Lord. And I beg you to believe what he said in his name. Don't speak with flesh and blood. Don't ask about the things of God from man. Only the Holy Scripture will answer those questions which are in the Holy Scriptures. In verse 11, and Jesus answered and said unto them, Elijah truly shall first come and restore all things. Now, in the prophet Isaiah 58, we read 11 and 12, that there will be a restoration. There will be a repair done. So much damage was done in comparison to the New Testament church. Everything was changed. All the teachings, all the practices were changed. A great damage was done. Everything was interpreted, misplaced and displaced. But now the time has come to lay the old foundations, to uncover them, just like the rebuilding of the temple took place. They did not lay a new foundation. They just took old things away until they found the old foundations. And then the temple was rebuilt on the same foundation. It's the same today. Not a new foundation, not new teachings, but the doctrines of the 12 apostles. Just as we read in Acts 2:42 about the New Testament church at the very beginning, remaining in the teachings of the apostles, in prayer, in fellowship, and so forth. But since the apostolic days, all was changed, and people live in traditions, thinking it's the word of God, believing it's biblical when it's not. Therefore, we have to compare the word of God with what we believe, and we must stand on God's word and believe what the scripture says. For instance, in Acts chapter 3, we are told about the return of Christ, but also that he remains in heaven until the times of restitution of all things would come. Already in chapter 2, the apostle Peter did not only speak about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which was to take place in the last days, according to the prophet Joel chapter 2, verse 29, in Acts 2, 17, he also spoke about the day of the Lord that would come in chapter 2 of the book of Acts. It says here in verse 20, the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and notable day of the Lord comes. And then it says here, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, if we go with this scripture to the next chapter, Acts chapter 3, it speaks here about repentance in verse 19, about the times of refreshing that will come from the presence of the Lord as promised in Isaiah 28, verse 12. And then the statement is found, and he shall send Jesus Christ, who before was preached unto you. And now comes the most important statement, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things. which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the time began. So there is a complete restitution, a restoration, a repairing, a laying of the foundation or uncovering the old foundation and to build again according to the Bible pattern. Beloved friends, brothers and sisters, I'm in the ministry for so many years in the kingdom of God. I am since 1949. I'm part of the revival which broke out after World War II when the Lord used William Branham as a man sent from God with a true ministry which was divinely confirmed already in the early 50s. Gordon Lindsay wrote the book A Man Sent from God, showing the picture of William Branham, whom the Lord used in such an incomparable way that we all could see that Bible days were here again. It was not only written in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, that Jesus Christ is the same. It was not only written in John 14, verse 12, the works that I do, shall you do also. I'm a witness for 10 years from 1955 till 1965. I was an eyewitness in his meetings in Europe and in the United States. I'm a witness of the supernatural things God has done in our generation. I saw with my own eyes a true apostolic prophetic ministry. I heard a man sent from God who preached the same gospel Peter and Paul was preaching, who baptized as they were baptizing, who set the order again. The Bible pattern was restored. The old foundation was seen again, and now we can build upon it. So God, at special times, uses someone to call his people back to himself and to his word. To understand the time we're living in is not enough to only speak about the end time, about the fulfillment of Bible prophecies. We must know what the Lord promised to the New Testament church, how she is to be called out, prepared, and made ready for the return of the bridegroom. Of course, everybody can read Matthew 25, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Everybody can preach about the 10 virgins and can explain who the foolish are and who the wise are. But now the time has come not to explain, but prepare, because the scripture says in Matthew 25, verse 10, they that were ready went in to the marriage and the door was closed. This is God's time to call his people out from all things that are unscriptural. They might sound biblical. And today, everybody uses Bible terminologies. Everybody speaks about Christianity. At the present time, we have 342 church denominations joined in the World Council of Churches. But Jesus Christ has only one church. He purchased, he paid the price, he shed his blood, he gave his life. So now he's calling out his church from all the churches and bring us back to himself and to his word to believe in him, as the scripture says. Beloved, this is a prophetic, an apostolic ministry. That means to say, we are brought back to the true word of God spoken unto us in the name of the Lord under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit by the apostles and prophets and the New Testament church according to Ephesians 2, is built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. May you hear his voice, line up with his word. May you be restored, is my prayer. God bless you. In Jesus' holy name, amen.